for 7Set Media. And today we have a special guest. We have Lawrence on the panel with us. We're about to delve into this. All right, Chris.
Okay. First topic, what's the state of Black love?
Well, I mean, right now, in this current time, I know there is some turmoil between Black women and Black men, but it's like that in general right now. I mean, most people aren't getting married. So, I mean, by default, most people aren't really dating. And by default, most Black people aren't dating, even though stats say that 80% of Black women will marry Black men and vice versa. I just think overall the traditionalist idea of Black love is dead.
Well, you should have handled it.
And that's, like I said before, that's part and due to things like social media, like a culture, feminism. So I don't think Black love is completely dead, but I do think the traditional idea that our parents had and our parents' parents had is dead. Like courtship, courting, and, you know, taking a person out and then getting to know them and getting approved by their family. That's dead.
Darius, your hope.
Well, going off of what E-Man said, it's like Black men and women don't look at each other as like the same anymore. They don't have the same attraction or love for each other anymore. And because of third wave feminism, the hookup culture, Tinder, you know, pump and dump relationships being at an all-time high, and we have no clear examples or morals of what the relationship should be sought by Black people, or the standards of what relationships should be sought by Black people, positive role models and figures in our family growing up. I mean, it's just my family right now. I mean,
yeah, you make a good point, because even, and it's not like just the common Black people, and their relationships aren't just messed up. Even the celebrity relationships between Black people are messed up. It's insane. So not only is it like the common Joe, but it's even the, you know, the rich people who are making over six figures. So yeah, like I said, the traditional idea of Black love on a broad scale, that's dead. Like I said, you know, I think most Black people, like I said, they're still gonna end up with Black people. So that's not really the problem. The problem is the courtship factor and the dating factor, and the where you get to meet someone and you take them out with them and their family. Cause we still kind of do that. You know, my family's from Africa, and we before you can get married, I forgot what it's called, but your spouse has to get approved by the other, the person you're marrying, their family. They have to get approved before you can even marry them. And it's a whole big tradition where it's called knock door, where basically you come over and they, you know, you get to meet the family, you meet the mother, you meet the grandma, and you meet everyone, and they pretty much approve or disapprove of you marrying their daughter or their son, or, well, usually the man approaches. So you marrying their daughter. And I don't, in terms of like American traditionalism, I don't see that. That's all gone.
So. All right.
That's real. Casey, have you recouped from your loss?
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
We have,
okay.
Can we hear you?
Well, my phone is doing something weird. But that's just. Why are you laughing? Maybe that's somebody in the background.
I'm gonna turn on my camera. I like that.
I don't know. That's a really broad question. That's just a really broad question. Like the state of Black love. I guess it's really poor right now. It looks like. Like everybody seems like Black men hate Black women and Black women hate Black men. And
you really believe that?
That's how it seems. That's really how it seems. Boy, what do you have to say about that?
No. You can elaborate. I'm just listening.
Well, when I say that, I guess I mean that, like, black women, it seems like they, I guess maybe there's like a misunderstanding. Maybe we don't understand each other. We blame each other a lot. That's one thing that gets in the way. We blame each other a lot.
Oh Lord, she just got dropped.
She didn't laugh.
Oh Lord.
I think
hey,
I have
can you, hey, you can you believe she tried to cook me last time? Anyway, yeah, go ahead.
Ooh.
She tried to cook me talking about my phone and my connection. Don't even try it.
Girl.
Comes in here. I'm a anyway, go ahead, Lawrence.
I think I have to disagree with all of you.
Really? Okay.
I believe that low-key, like, black love in this day and age, low-key is popping. And I say this because right now we're in a stage where black people are kind of coming into terms with being black. Like, they're kind of, like, accepting the fact that they're black. And with that is accepting their own race, meaning that they're trying to be okay with dating more people black, which means that black people are trying to accept the fact that they're dating black people and they're not hiding from it like they used to.
Okay, so Lawrence, you think things are just dope right now because
because it's like we're coming into terms with being black. It's like more people are accepting it. Well, more black people are accepting black people dating black people, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
In my opinion.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. It's a good point.
Good point.
Is Papoose simping by staying with or allowing Remy Ma to continuously push out blatant feminist rhetoric and propaganda?
Okay, now this one is interesting because here you go with you have Remy Ma talking about the patriarchy and how, you know, men have too much and this and this. But wait a minute, you're married to a man. So is it that do you have the same thoughts and ideals about him, or is it just the men outside of your sphere of influence? Because I mean, does Papoose know she's putting out stuff like this? Does he know that she feels this way about men and the page and the invisible and non-existent patriarchy? What patriarchy? Especially when it comes to black patriarchy, there is no black patriarchy.
Facts.
So what is she talking about? So is she talking about white men? Is she talking about black men, or is she talking about all men?
She says that men have too many rights, even though women have more rights than men.
Yeah, women have my body, my choice. They have pretty much full parental rights. So what is she talking about? And Papoose, why? What are you doing?
Why did he allow that in the first place?
Check your woman. Your woman is running off at the mouth talking nonsense. Check your woman, man. Come on.
Exactly. Indeed.
Anyway, but that's just my opinion.
Now, I bring this up because there's I'm not naming any names, but there's a person here who doesn't believe in the word simping or the action of such. I'm not naming names, but they know who they are, and yeah. So
can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yo, Chris.
What's up, bro?
Okay. Yeah, my phone is kind of
terrible,
so that's why I didn't say anything, but I'll just go ahead and try to get this out. So yeah, I don't like the word simping. I find that a man is respectful, like overly respectful toward a woman, they call it simping, and I think it's like actually to use that word. And I don't see, okay, just because she has a certain thought process. Like, what does that have to do with him? She's not, why does he have to let her do anything? Like, if that's how she thinks, she might not even think like that. Cause the do some type of like kind of feminist freestyle or whatever it was for some magazine. And it was some like white owned magazine. And maybe they had told her, no, but for whatever reason that she's doing it, like, what does that have to do with him? They're two different people, and I feel like there has not been like a logical reason put forth as to why being because of something that he thinks.
Okay, well, let's talk about it. And now you said they're two different people, but wait a minute, when you're married under the state, you become one. So, I mean, what about that? And she's dropping it. I was about to light her up and she leaves. Come on, man. That internet, dude.
McDonald's Wi-Fi.
There it is.
Across the street.
Here is my perspective on it. She needs to be checked. This nigga way too far ahead. Because she says all these negative things about men, especially black men in particular. That means you must have the same mentality towards your husband, Papoose. If that was the case, you don't really even need to be married.
Yeah, and she said something else that I didn't really agree with. She said, okay, maybe someone is just telling her to say this, but the point is you're still putting the message out and it's under your banner. So the repercussions of that is going to happen on your watch. You just can't take something that someone's trying to say. And
my thing is that, you know, when you get to a certain point financially, your marriage has to become stronger. Because the more resources you manage, the more of a liability it is your partner might flake on you or do something shady. So it is always in your best interest to at least consult your partner with business decisions, you know, to let them know how it's going to affect them. Because especially when you're famous or decently famous or well known, you don't have to be famous. This applies to like local politicians. You know, if you're married and once one of you do something and if that is poorly received, then that reflects back on the other person. But it's like, why didn't you tell them not to do that? Why did they do that? You know, why aren't y'all communicating? Like, what type of marriage is that? So I just think, you know, it's ridiculous. And then let's say if she was paid to say those things. Your man is out here doing alphabetical pro-black raps, you know.
Right.
I mean, wearing all this pan-African pro-black stuff. Like, he's been doing this for years now. And you're going to come out, let a white company pay you to say something you don't believe in. That's still flex badly on Papoose, because it's like, why would you marry a person like that? That's hypocritical. And then, excuse me. And then if you think about it, like, that's what is the point behind all of it? Because it's obvious that she did it to be relevant again. You know, first it was the Nicki Minaj beast diss, and it's like, you know, the diss was okay, but it's like, I didn't think it was impressive, because it's like, you told everybody that Nicki Minaj was a conniving hoe. Guess what? Everybody already thought Nicki Minaj was a conniving hoe. Like, and it just wasn't that powerful to me. And then she came out with the feminist rap thing, and she could have been paid to do it, but then that reflects badly. And if she actually believes all that stuff, I believe that if you're married to a feminist, that's automatic simping. Let me explain. Because feminists exist today to emasculate men.
Yeah.
In all honesty. So yeah. That means you are okay with being emasculated. That's simping. Now, you know, all of this.
Did you say feminists emasculate men?
Emasculate, yes.
Yes, it does.
It does.
Okay.
And now, you know, so what, you had this feminist rap and then another diss. This is a clear cut tactic to get rich or get relevant again. If I could compare it to something, this is essentially the ghetto version of what Beyonce did with Lemonade. You know, do something random and spiteful and against your husband, but you're still gonna stay with him. But in reality, it was just a way to stir up females and get back relevance to, you know, push sales again. So
I don't think
it reflects good on anybody.
Okay, but I don't see, from what I heard her say, maybe feminism overall, like, it's in some ways it can be emasculating to men, but nothing that she said, as far as I can remember, was emasculating men. Like, she was just talking about how things aren't fair or equal in, you know, society when it comes to men and women. And maybe you may agree or disagree, but that's all that she was saying. And that's not like emasculating men. Like, that's not saying anything negative toward men, really. So
yeah, but she's essentially lying. Didn't she bring up the pay wage gap?
Yeah, the wage gap that doesn't
exist. A lie. And we have empirical evidence that says it's a lie. That as you go up in the ladder, men, the earnings of men and women become the same. So that's a lie, and that's the same old tired rhetoric that feminists always repeat. And it's a blatant lie. So why is she continuing to say that?
But then in the rap, she kept harping on about the pay wage gap that doesn't exist. And then if you noticed at the end, she said, "Anyway, I think women should get paid more." For what?
Entitlement.
For what? Like it's like it was such a shameless, just feminist, look at me, my vagina gives me special abilities. Like it was just terrible. And to me, I would say if I was Papoose, I'd be embarrassed right now. I'd be so embarrassed. And if
I'll say that, or like, now that you have explained, like, now you all have explained, like, what is the connection with simping and what she did and everything, I can see why you all would say what you're saying. So yeah, I can see that. I still don't like that word, because usually I just feel like it's usually being used for when, you know, when men are just overly respectful, like when they are, you know, if they're praising a woman, oh, he's simping, or if they're saying that something is, that maybe it may be a slight toward men, but it might be true, he's simping, even if it's true. Like,
I mean, praising women is simping. Because putting a female on a pedestal is simping. No, yeah, why? Exactly. I thought they're all equal. There's no reason to put a female on a pedestal.
But then what they really mean to do is that they think they're gonna compliment their way into some pussy.
Yeah, and that shit don't work.
That's pathetic, in all honesty.
I feel like that is not always like their intent. Sometimes you just want to tell the truth, and sometimes the truth might be things like this.
Listen, as a guy, let me tell you something. As a guy, we're just trying to hit. Don't wait for the punchline. That's it. We're trying to hit.
That's your intent toward every single thing that you ever say.
Look.
You never tell the truth about anything.
No.
Go ahead.
Go ahead.
What he's saying is that vast majority, like I'd be willing to say 95% of men that unnecessarily compliment are trying to inch their way into a woman's hands. 95% of the time. Now, when you're simping in a... Well, here's the thing. You get a compliment when you deserve a compliment.
Exactly.
Now, the reason why simping is in a negative connotation the majority of the time is that women feed off of those compliments. It boosts the ego. They like that attention. And a lot of them will play around and keep... They literally keep guys around just to feed off of the attention and the constant compliments, because it boosts their ego. It helps with their self-esteem. Now...
Also...
Wait, don't cut the man's flow. Wait. Keep going.
Now, what I mean by that is that, you know, if you want your self-esteem boosted, I mean, you know, hey, but don't do it don't lead somebody on. And this goes for men and women. I don't like when anybody leads anybody on. And that's what simping is a majority of the time, is females leading different dudes on for attention, because they have the vain thought that, hey, you know, if I compliment her enough, then maybe we can go on a date. And then maybe after I pay for like 6 dates, then like maybe she'll give me a hand job and everything will be cool. And like, I'll be happy. And then, you know, it's like a majority of dudes that overly compliment usually just want sex. Now, a real dude, in my opinion, will just like, a compliment is just a beginning phase in that conversation to something like, okay, yeah, I like your, I don't know, purse, or I don't know, like, you know, I like so-and-so, you know, where'd you get it from? Okay, that's dope. I actually know a bistro around the corner from where you got it from. Do you want to go there later? But no, a majority of dudes will just compliment and compliment every day until she thinks to herself, let me give him my number, okay? If she gives him the number, then I can have 24/7 compliments and 24/7 emotional support. That's not right. That's leaving somebody.
That's it right there.
So,
and
okay. All right. You're going to add to that?
Oh, no.
Because I have something else to say.
I was saying, girl. Oh, if you don't. But, and then there's the dudes that just compliment. Oh, my God. Did she just drop? She dropped.
Yeah.
This is about to be...
Trying to lace her with game and she drops. Man, come on.
That's her own game. A meme is going to be made by the end of the night at this rate.
Yeah, you need to. She needs it.
But I'll just finish up. So when there's a dude that just compliments and he's not expecting anything, I think that there's an ulterior motive. When they consistently compliment just to compliment, I think a lot of those dudes end up being like, they're actually miserable, in all honesty, but they just don't want to come out to it. So, you know, I don't know, Darius, do you have anything to add?
Well, I also was going to add, like, the dudes who do overcompliment women so much that women see them as they can be manipulated in some sort of way, that they can control them to do whatever they want. And to doing whatever they want. Like, they'll just say and do things to make men, you know, like, overly compliment them or boost or hype up their ego in some sort of way. I only compliment a woman when she deserves a compliment. I just don't overdo it, because it's just not, it's too much.
You know, I think it should be mutual. You shouldn't give out compliments day after day after day. It should definitely be mutual. And that's how you really can measure where your relationship with the female is. If it's not mutual, then you're wasting your time. And that's what I always tell. I tell this to my brothers, my two youngest and my older. If you're not getting the same amount of attention that you're giving, then leave. Yeah. It's that simple. Don't even waste your time. If she's not as interested in you as you are in her, if you send a text, she takes like 2 hours to leave. I mean, don't waste your time. Either anything else is just feeding. It's feeding into her her ego. Did that answer your question?
Okay, so. Who, me?
Yeah.
Yeah, I did. But, okay, so you like just it. Before. Huh? What'd you say?
No, no, go ahead.
All right, before we move on, I just want to be clear. Mm. You might have already answered this, and maybe I just didn't hear it because, you know, I got kicked off the call a couple of times. But, yeah, but I just want to be clear. So, the reason why you're calling Papoose a simp is not because of the way that he treats his wife. It's because of her actions, because of her and the feminist thing, not because of the way that he treats her.
I will say this. Papoose is either a simp or he's not a good guy. And what I mean by that, he's either a simp for allowing her to do this, or he's not a good guy by going back on his principles that he's put out over these years that directly contradict what she said. So
it's about what she's doing, not the way that, because I was thinking that you meant that it was because of, like, before I had even seen her, you know, do the whole feminist rap and everything, just the way that he treats her, like, he seems like he's just like a really good husband. He, you know, he probably seems like he does love her more than she loves him. Uh-oh. And, you know, he gives a lot of attention, all that stuff. What?
I think it's very risky to be in a relationship where you like somebody more than they like you. But,
A man should always like a woman more.
A man is always supposed to like a woman more. Hold on now. I got to get close to the camera. A man is always supposed to like a woman more. But I'm about to say these days, 7 times, women are the ones dependent on the man.
Women are the ones dependent on a man.
Usually, what in modern. Usually in marriages and relationships, the man is the main pillar. If the man gets sick, everybody's about to suffer. If the woman gets sick, we can work around that. In most relationships, it's probably less than 30 years ago, but these days, if a man is the main provider, that's his job. What the fuck was that? So why is a man supposed to like a woman more when I believe it should be the other way around? I feel like you should like the one that provides you food and safety and shelter and opportunities more than they love you.
Yeah, you love him. You're supposed to like him and everything, but he's supposed to like love you more.
Why?
Because
shouldn't it be mutual? Like
mutual, D. Like
no, it shouldn't be mutual.
What? Let's see. That's dangerous, man. Come on.
Oh my god. Oh my god. Which man he left?
I can't with you right now, Cole. I can't.
No.
You got us dying every time. That connection.
Oh my god. Oh shit.
Okay.
Hurry up, because you got like 5 minutes to the next disconnect, so let's make it quick.
Casey's phone is saying, girl, you're not about to get any of this game. Fuck that.
No, my phone agrees with me. It's just that we should have started this a long time ago, because I knew that my phone's going to start acting up. Anyway.
So I'm saying it's simp behavior is coming from this feminist freestyle thing. I believe. I always thought Papoose was a good dude because, you know, he always wore the black love shirts and then he always talked about her when she was in prison. I'm like, he was like this girl. And then he comes.
I think he does.
Yeah, but it's just the whole feminist. You allowed her to do that. That reflects poorly on you.
But maybe that's how she feels. I mean, what? He's supposed to just like up and divorce her because of the way that she thinks?
You don't become a feminist overnight.
She was in prison for a long time.
Most women don't become feminists in their 30s and 40s. They become feminists in their teens to early 20s. She's been like this for a while. If she's been like this for a while and if he's put up with it, that still reflects badly on him.
Yeah. That's true.
I can see that, but I still think he's
Remy Ma was in prison eating clams. He's out here, black love, guys. She was in there being the click cop. And he's, I mean, honestly, I'm just saying he's simping for this. I'm going to leave it at that. That's it for me. That's all, folks. All right.
Cool. All right.
Next topic. We should blaze through these fast.
Yeah.
If you could give your younger self relationship advice, what would it be?
I would tell myself to stay single. Stay single. Until you're ready. Until you got your stuff together. Right. That's it.
Yeah, same for me. I would tell myself just don't even worry because 15 years from now, when you're established, you know, you'll have all the resources and the money to do what you want to do. You'll be able to travel. Don't get married, stay single, and stay on the track. That's all. That's all you need to do.
Yeah, same here. I tell myself to stay focused, you know, stay persistent, be the underdog that you are. 15 years from now, when you have a lot of things, and you're successful, and you're a prominent man, you'll be able to date a lot of women that you want. A lot of women that you want. So, it's a lot of things I just go back and tell myself.
I would tell myself in freshman year of high school to date Nadia because she liked you and she had a lot of money.
This dude was trying to marry up. That's whole shit. That's smart, though.
I have no regrets outside of that, honestly.
That's some whole shit.
Never mind. Well, okay, so I tell myself to date Nadia. Nadia wasn't ugly. Nadia was kind of cute. She was kind of stupid. She wasn't stupid. She was just spacing. But they date Nadia and to never talk to Naraya. That's it.
Okay. What about Mr. Lawrence?
Lawrence dropped. He caught the Casey syndrome. He caught Casey.
All right, so next topic.
Acute internet connection deficiency syndrome. Let me see. What do you think is more admirable, a stay-at-home mom or a career-driven mom? I just dropped my fucking lighter. Hold on. Yeah, so a career-driven mom or a stay-at-home mom. What do you guys think is more admirable or wantable?
I mean, do you mean that in terms of... I mean, honestly, I think a stay-at-home mom.
Yeah.
Okay.
To be honest.
Yeah.
Because as a stay-at-home mom, you put the house together. You got to take care of the kids. You got to clean the house. And you pretty much give up whatever career you're going to have to stay at home and take care of the kids while the guy goes out and makes the money. So personally, and I know feminists hate that, but personally, I think that shows a stronger character and a more focused vision to be a stay-at-home mom. A Sam, that's what they call it.
Okay.
Sam.
Casey?
You know she dropped and came back, right? Y'all know that, right?
I almost walked out the room again.
y'all weren't talking? Okay, well, I'll go real quick. So, I respect both of them because I don't respect either one more than the other. Because it all depends on what type of life that you want. Like, I think that that's like the best, you know, part of, I think that it's great to be able to choose. And not everybody can choose. A lot of women have to work. Like, if you're a single mom, like, you have to work, you know, with a man who doesn't have that much money, you have to, you're forced to work. I think that it's great to have the opportunity to be a stay-at-home mom, if you can. So, both of them. Hey, if you're a stay-at-home mom and you do, and you're actually like a good stay-at-home mom, because you know it's easy, but a lot of people say it's really hard work. If you have a bunch of kids, you gotta, you know, take care of the kids all day, you have to cook, clean, all of that stuff. So they're both very challenging positions, and respect both of them equally.
Okay. So, what's next? Tyrese and his wife. Come on, go ahead.
She got some. Okay. All right. She got something to say.
Oh, you can go.
I want to hear what you got to say, because I already have my. I already have what I have to say.
Yeah, I had already like said something about this like on a comment somewhere. Pretty much, I didn't like the fact that he said that he called her a black woman because she's clearly mixed. You know, some mixed people do consider themselves black, and I guess that's, you know, I mean, that is what it is. I'm not about to tell somebody, oh, well, you can't be black, you can't consider yourself black, but like, they can call themselves what they want to, but I'm going to call you mixed because, and I was talking to somebody about this a while back, like, it's kind of not, it's not fair to black women to call mixed women black too, because we don't always have like the same experiences. So it's just, it's not the same thing, like, especially when it comes to beauty standards. Like, sometimes, like, they were saying that, you know, Halle Berry a lot of times is considered like the epitome of a beautiful black woman, when really she's mixed. And a lot of women with two black parents, we don't look like that. So, you know, like, it's not really fair to call mixed women black. And so I think that in Tyrese, he probably has a color complex. He probably like, you know, lighter skin, closer to white women. And so, but he probably doesn't want to face that. So that's why he's calling her black, trying to make himself feel better. Just like, I don't know if y'all know about Tank. He's another singer that Tyrese is in a group with. And he also has, he faced a lot of backlash when he was posting stuff with his wife, because she's also mixed. And he was like, I don't know why y'all are upset because she's black and everything. Like, but in order to kind of not have to deal with it or not feel like they're being self-hating, they call these women black. And that's.
Yeah. Okay. Hey, lucky she said her piece. But here's what I have to say. You know, it's interesting because in the USA, the USA is the only place where mixed people are considered black. You can't go to any other country on the planet and see that mixed people are considered like full black or full white. They're classified as mixed race. And yeah, Tyrese did call her my black queen. But what's interesting is that it's been reported that she's actually, her mother is Hispanic and her father's Caucasian. So with that being said, it's quite obvious, and you can look at her features and you can tell that she's not even close to being black. You can look at her nose You can look at her eyes. You can look at the construction of her face, and you can tell she clearly, I mean, certain black people can look like that, but she's not black. So I believe Tyrese is, he's something psychologically is going on with him where he feels this need to call her my black queen, because like Shay mentioned, he probably has a complex. So he's trying to compensate for that by calling, he put out the hashtag my black queen, and he had to take it down the next day because of all the backlash he was getting. So I just think we need to stop this colorism shit, man. Like, it's 2017 and we still have this notion of white, bright, damn near white is better than, you know, any other skin color of black people. It's ridiculous.
Right. And I just want to say that also, that like, I don't have any problem with him marrying a mixed woman or a light-skinned woman or whatever, but it's just the fact that you can see that that's his preference. And it's like, why is that your preference? It's really like, and of course the fact that he called her black, but I feel like dark skin, everybody needs love, so I don't see any problem with it, but it's just, that shouldn't be, I don't see why that is your preference. Like, there, I think there's a problem with that, but that's all.
I have a problem with it on the economics level. Y'all know I love bringing up money when it comes to marriages, and the problem with marrying someone who's non-black is 95% of the time women live longer than men, so when you die, she inherits all your money, if they're even still together. So, well, yeah, what are the chances that she's going to take that money back to the black community and help the black community with his money?
Well, in my opinion, if she's mixed, then there's a chance. Like,
she's not mixed. Her father is Caucasian. Her mother is Hispanic.
Oh, I saw a picture of her mom, and she looked like she had dark skin and everything. Like, she looked black.
There's she black Hispanics. Is. Yeah, black Hispanics.
So it's not okay to date black Hispanics?
I mean, but look at her. I bet she doesn't consider herself black. Now, remember, Tyrese called her black. She never said she was black.
Yeah, I agree with that. But since her mom is black, then you don't think that she, or black Hispanic, you don't think that she has any type of, that she might, had access to Tyrese's money to help the black Hispanic community, like, that's a possibility.
No.
I don't see anything wrong with that. No.
I honest to God,
it's not a possibility.
Yeah. I honest to God, I just don't believe that at this point. I just don't.
So who is supposed to marry mixed people? Are mixed people just supposed to marry each other? Like,
this is the reason why other cultures and other groups tend to, and I don't really agree with it 100%, but this is why they tend to only marry like within their group. They don't like going outside their group and marrying. And I'm starting to understand why, because you were put on this earth to acquire resources and money. And what happens when you marry outside of that group, when you marry like white Hispanics, or you marry, you know, Kanye's married to what? Where is she from? Kim K? Yeah, when you marry people like that, what you're doing is you're pretty much giving away your wealth, and you're mixing your wealth with other people's groups. And chances, and like I said, women live longer than men. So the chances that she's going to help out your group when you're dead is almost zero. And, you know, these people don't consider themselves black, so why would they help with your struggle? Even if
yeah, I hear you. I feel like I don't think that every mixed person is the same, and I mean, I personally feel like there's not any, unless you know that person, like unless you know them personally, there's no way of knowing if they're, you know, going to be, if they care about black people more, or they care about their white side more than their black side or whatever. Black people who have a bunch of money and don't spend it with black people either, or don't use it to help the black community. So I don't know. I think that what you mean, though. I do see what you mean.
Okay. It says she participated in Miss Latina UGA pageant in 2011.
You can be Latino.
I'm just looking through information. Yeah, yeah. She identifies as Latin American. Okay. Yeah, it's just interesting. Just interesting that he called her black queen.
Yeah, that is. I think that's completely incorrect. And I think that, you know, he kind of deserved a lot of the slander that he received.
All right, next topic.
Arranged marriages. I'm for arranged marriages.
I am too. I definitely am.
Arranged marriages.
Yeah. They make sense.
They really do.
That's interesting. That's interesting. Very interesting.
Because, like I said, this is kind of how we kind of have pieces of that in African tradition. Like I talked about the knock door tradition. It's not necessarily arranged, but like I said, your family, you have to get approved by your wife's family or your fiance's family before you can even marry her. And you have to get, there's like a trial period, we call it a trial period, where you have to basically have to get to know them. You just can't marry her. You gotta get to know them. She dropped?
No, she's still here.
Oh, okay. So anyway, you have to get to know the person before you can even marry them. And I think that's, I understand why. So I think maybe we shouldn't bring it back full force, but we should probably bring back pieces of it. It would make more for more stable marriages.
Yeah, because I always hear talk about, damn, who the fuck is getting abducted right now? Shit. Okay.
Oh man.
Because I always hear about people or women, especially single mothers, saying that, oh, I didn't know he was gonna be a deadbeat and run off on me.
Right.
Gonna be this. I didn't know how he was gonna do that. And I'm just like, I see terrible people. But if this guy's getting dragged through the center right now, so oh my god, stop.
Oh my goodness. Too much.
Casey's still alive. Casey, do
y'all keep cracking jokes every time I get dropped?
Yeah.
I'm over here hearing somebody getting
just go on with the show. Okay, it's okay. Don't pay me any mind. Just go on with the show.
So, you know, I'm just like, maybe if we had a process to where we could vet people, or families vet people, I feel like that definitely helped with a lot of single mothers, since a lot of women apparently can't tell when dudes are terrible. So, I think it's worthy. I think it's a decent enough idea.
You sound like you have some opposition to that.
Yeah, Casey, you're like, arranged marriage? Mm-hmm.
Oh, I don't have really an opinion on that, really. But you had said it seems like a lot of women what is the last thing you just said? You said that it seems like a lot of women can't seem to find or recognize a good man. So that's why we need arranged marriage?
No, I'm saying how a lot of women, especially single mothers, have told me that they didn't know this dude was going to be a deadbeat. They didn't know he was going to be a terrible person. They just didn't know. And I'm just like, how do you not know? Like, I could see terrible people from a mile away.
Okay.
So maybe if we had more family vetting processes, there'd be more people involved in being like, yo, he looks like he wants to skeet and skedaddle. We need to watch out for him.
Exactly.
Okay. Yeah, I can see that. I mean, I don't think that's really realistic, but that's why I was kind of like, arranged marriage. Like, I just don't see that being realistic in this society. But yeah, cool.
Wait, what? Wait, why not?
I fucking love Casey. She just be disagreeing with everything. I fucking love that.
Wait, why not? You know, we still have a marriage is still kind of arranged in like royal families and all that. Why can't we do that on a smaller scale? Even in Africa, like I just talked about, the knock door tradition. Yeah, the knock door tradition is basically like a little facet of an arranged marriage.
What, Casey?
How are you gonna get that started? Like, how are you gonna, what, so you're gonna start with your kids? Like, oh, let me, you know, find somebody for you.
My family does it to me.
Well, yeah, but like I just said before, if...
Huh?
Is there a woman that your family has found for you and eventually you guys are going to get married?
No, I'm saying that, he's saying that on a smaller scale, a family vetting process.
Yeah, like if you meet... If you meet a female that you like, or if you meet a dude that you like, bring him. Just don't, you know, go off with them. Bring him to the family and introduce him. Because, you know, usually mothers can see a bad dude from a mile away. And usually guys can see a bad guy from miles away. Because you know how a guy thinks, because you're a guy. Women know how women think because they're women. So bring him or her to the family and introduce them, you know, let them mingle, let the family get a feel for them. That way you know whether or not that he's, you know, a decent guy or not. And it shouldn't just be like a one-time thing. Bring him around and right. Let him see how he interacts with your family. That's how we start. It starts on a small scale. And you don't necessarily have to do arranged marriages, but do it on a small scale.
I know that, like, every time.
Oh.
I hang out with one of my mom's friends that I haven't like talked to at all, or I don't know about. They like always end up telling my mom, like, yo, like, how old is, like, I have a daughter. And I'm like, you know, I think arranged marriages would realistically still happen if I think in a way parents still want it to happen.
They do. They do on a small scale.
Because every parent knows how rough it is. Yep. And they don't want that to be reciprocated. Because they know if we mess up, then it's like a whole line of the family's doomed.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting. That's very interesting. I agree. I definitely agree. Okay.
And, dope. So, on to the next one. Of course she dropped. Okay, so
again,
this is getting comical at this point. So is no snitching killing the black community?
Yes. And I'll weigh in on this one.
Finally.
Damn.
The reason why I say this is because you have all types of people. I mean, crazy. I mean, the range people within the community out here killing innocent women, children, and the elderly, and other black men for no fucking reason.
Obedient.
And there are not people, not necessarily going to tell the police, because at this point, the police shouldn't be involved in our issues, and they're not going to help us. And plus, they hate us as a race. What I'm saying, I'm not saying you should snitch on anybody for doing what they're doing, you know. They're selling weed, you know, trying to hustle to make ends meet. Not telling you should snitch on anybody for that. But if you see people who are fucking up our own in the community, as far as women, children, infants, and the elderly, you have to come back and tell other black men what's really going on so we can do something to pump
them. Yeah, ski mask club. Yeah.
Exactly. I just see all types of people out here in the world fucking up black women. This is our own. Some of our own people are fucking up black women and older people and children and infants. You hear all types of stories about this.
Yeah, like the dude, like the Chicago shooting now, Chris. Calm down for a second.
Wait, hold on.
How that female was shot on Facebook Live, man.
Yes.
What was that about? Chris, what about black on black crime? Just do walk away. trying to put that man on blast. I gotta do so much editing, but yeah, I understand what you're saying, man. Especially when you think about the rates, there is pedophilia in the Black community, and usually what happens is it goes untreated and it goes unnoticed. So that no snitching rule really comes back to bite us, because a lot of these Black feminists were molested at a young age, and you know we have this no snitching rule, so they never told anyone. So nothing ever happened about it, and so they have to go on. Now that's just a tiny few. There's a lot of pretend Black feminists, and then there's like Black feminists who were actually molested as children. So there's a lot of fuckery that goes on. And the no stitching rule definitely it's a detriment to the Black community, especially where it counts. Like, people talk about no snitching when it comes to like stupid shit, but you need to be, you know, you need to tell someone when it's serious issues like pedophilia, murders of children, murders of innocent women, murders of elderly, like just random drive-bys. That's what you need to tell someone, and not, like you said, not necessarily the police, but you can tell the community of Black people, if you have one, the Ski Mask Club, you tell them and let them handle it.
Yeah.
Exactly. Just like that.
Exactly. And then I be telling people, if you're a person who's selling drugs, at least don't sell it in your community.
Yeah, that's another good one.
Take that shit to different neighborhoods for the white community and sell it over there. And if you make money, put it back into your community. At least do that. I'm not making a hustle or making a come up, trying to make ends meet for your family. If you're gonna sell drugs, take it to the other communities and then make money over there and bring it back to the communities and look out for your people. That's all I'm saying. But when it comes to serious issues like pedophilia, molestation, rape, killings of innocent children, women, and elderly people, there's something that needs to be done about that. You can't let that go under the radar. And then a lot of people in the community go let it go under the radar because because
most of the time it's a family member with the fuckery. It's usually the uncle or the brother or the cousin. So that's why a lot of times they don't want to snitch, because it's someone who's really closer than you think to the family. So they don't want to tell. But, you know, if it's that serious, you have to tell. Someone needs to be notified, or else the child's future or the woman's future could be destroyed. So,
exactly. And then you have people that be like, "Oh, I don't want to snitch because I don't want to get dealt with anything like that." No, when it's something serious like that, you have to notify somebody right away. You have to tell somebody about these things. And then you have other people. I mean, you have young, innocent black boys who are teenagers that are getting killed out here for no fucking reason.
All right, next topic.
Next topic.
Okay.
What are ways that Black people can empower themselves?
It's this thing that Tyreek had mentioned in Hidden Colors 4 called the CMB mentality. Right? CMB mentality.
What's that?
And I think I have to look at it again and see what the C means. But I know what the M and B means is to establish a militarize your mind and yourself as a melanoid person, and then B is for build. You build communities, you build your wealth, you empower yourself as a melanoid. You build economically as a collective group, you know, things like that. There are plenty of ways that Black people can empower themselves. Individually, I think people just have to start loving themselves and, you know, think highly of themselves and be more confident of themselves, about themselves and who they are and what they can do. Empowering themselves by small steps day to day throughout their lives. and financially and economically, just start reading more, you know, start investing in stocks, start looking at bonds, start looking at trust funds, start writing out business plans, you know, come up with very creative and tangible things that could create wealth in you, so you can generate long wealth in the run, so your children and descendants can have wealth for themselves. They will have to depend on other groups of people. That's what we're looking at. That's
real
what
shit,
we should
Darius.
Do.
Real shit.
Great. Great.
Yeah, I have nothing to add. You hit the nail on the head, man. We got to get that economic base. That's all it comes down to. Got to get the economic base. And I like how he mentioned generational wealth. Perfect. Well said. You can go to the next topic.
Great. Next topic, Shay Shay has not returned. Oh, yes, she did.
Oh, you didn't see her slipping?
Yes, yeah. I did.
She went to go make her some movie. And then she came back.
She had to go pay her ransom, but
no.
next up is the word nigga cool or not? I don't care. I mean, like, y'all know I say it. I don't like when I was younger. I was like 13 and 14, and like in my hotep phase, like I don't know. I was like, don't say that word. Don't say that word. Don't say that word. And then I sat back and I thought about it. I'm like, why? Like, okay, so for example, do y'all know where the word slave comes from? It comes from the
isn't it like a servant? Is that what it's supposed to mean? It's like a European word from like word, Slavic, right?
Yeah, okay. It comes from Slavic, Slav. And so you have an entire group of people, Slavs, who are known as being slaves. And actually, their culture group's name means slave. And they still call themselves Slav. And they've had, you know, some pretty powerful countries come from them. I mean, you know, the majority of them are Russian. You know what? The USSR, the Russian Empire, even the Russian Federation is pretty powerful to an extent. Poland, Lithuanian Commonwealth. I mean, like, they've done some extremely great things in terms of nation building, and yet they still call themselves Slav. So that has to really beg the mind, like, what matter? The fact that they call themselves Slavs, or the fact that they didn't just sit there and accept, you know, the onslaught or the trash that Western Europeans threw their way. So I don't think saying not saying nigga is really that serious in the long run. I feel like stopping people from saying nigga is just a way for a lot of black people to feel like they're making a difference instead of actually making a difference. That's my take on it.
Okay. I thought that Slavic meant servant, not slave, but I could be wrong. I haven't really, you know, looked into that too much, so I don't know why they call themselves that, but I just think, okay, that's fine for them. If other black people want to call themselves the N-word or call other black people the N-word, I definitely don't stop them. I personally am not going to be saying that. There's a lot of things that I don't say, so, you know, that's just one other thing. But I don't say it just because it doesn't make sense to me. Like, well, we didn't grow up like it was, you know, not something that, like, my mom didn't like, you know, that word. So yeah, so that's just, but the reason, my logic behind why I continue to not say it is because it did come from something that, you know, a word that white people used negatively toward black people, and so it kind of just, to me, it seems, then turn around and call yourself something that was supposed to mean a negative word, and it still is used in a negative way, because, like, it's used in both kind of, because you know, the first thing that if you get mad at somebody, like if you get mad at another black person, you're gonna call them the N-word, or you might call them the B-word. Mm-hmm. But both of those terms, then people are like, oh, well, you know, it's, they're used as a term of endearment. Like, how can you use a word that is supposed to kind of mean an insult in some situations? How can you use that to mean something good in another situation? That doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's why I don't use it.
Yeah. And you want to say something? Ahead.
I feel like that a lot of that comes from men, because men generally casually insult each other a lot more than I've seen women do it anyway. And I could definitely see how it went from nigga to this. And
what do you mean casually insult? Because when they are mad, like if you are mad at somebody, you're gonna call them, like a lot of times men or women, they'll call them the N-word. Just like women are mad at another woman, they'll call them the B-word.
I think that's different. Usually when a man gets mad at another man, they just don't use nigga. They use a prefix to it, like you bitch ass nigga, you hoe ass nigga. Nobody says, ah, you fucking nigga. Like, who says that?
Yeah, that's true.
I heard other black men casually call each other's nigga, like, yo, nigga, what's up?
That's not the context we're talking
about. That's different. I'm talking about like when somebody's mad, and then I've never seen somebody be like, ah, man, you nigga, you know. And then like, I think that's different than bitch, because I've never seen a female. I mean, I've seen females be like, you bitch. It's like, okay, but with men, it's like there's usually more to it, you know.
Yeah, I see what you mean.
But
yeah, you're right.
I also feel like there's just this massive wave of misinformation that's always pushed through the conscious community has influenced me and just being okay with saying it. Like, I'm pretty sure everyone has seen it at this point. It's like the meme where it says that nigger comes from negro in Spanish, and that comes from negro in Latin, and that comes from necro in Greek, and that means dead. It's like, no, that's not true. That's not where the word comes from. I've taken a year of Latin. I've studied Greek and Latin cultures. Not where the word comes from. The word is literally a Mediterranean word that means black. It literally just means black. And if y'all are, if we're gonna be upset about nigger, are we gonna be upset about more also, which is the same word that originates from the Mediterranean region of Africa, or the Mediterranean region of the Iberian Peninsula, that means black. But at the same time, it's like the word is not okay because it was used in slavery in a bunch of in a negative context. But then it's like a lot of words were used in slavery in a negative context. Like, honestly, like there's millions of people calling each other coons. I mean, at this point, me and my friends will just be messing around with each other. We'll be like, why are you acting like a coon? Like, we're not just like, ah, you fucking coon.
Yeah, that's
people
the same
call
thing.
Each other coons.
Coon is the same thing.
But nobody
that
cares.
Is the same thing.
Nobody cares. Coon was literally invented to insult black people. The word nigger has way more history than just black people.
Here's my thing.
But isn't negro what you're saying means black, not the N-word. The N-word, that is something that is, it may have derived from, it's not negro, it's something completely different. So it's that word, that form of the word that is problematic, not negro. I mean, shoot, if the people walk around calling each other that, I mean, that would be fine. I wouldn't see any problem with that, but that's not the word.
But then if you want to say if the form of the word doesn't matter, when was the last time y'all went around some black people, y'all like, what's up, nigger? Like, who's really saying, what's up, my nigger? What's up, nigger? Nigger, hey, nigger, what are you doing, nigger? Bro, this crazy nigger over there, like, who, black people aren't saying nigger though. It's specifically with an A. You want to know why we say it with an A? Because that's just how we talk. That's our form of the word. Like,
you say nigger.
Nigger. Yeah, it's like I've never thought it was. I mean, of course, at one point I did think it was super serious, but at this point, I just don't think it's so serious. Especially again, nigger has a history thousands of years older than slavery, at least our enslavement. Coon was specifically made during slavery. Why is nobody upset at Coon?
I don't like the similar fact that everybody's calling each other that, but yeah. I see what you mean though, like how they did, you know, change the form of the original N word to add an A to it, and so that kind of does. But I feel like I think that there is a reason why people get upset about this word. Like, it still is something that is, like, has a negative charge to it. That's why when a lot of times when white people say it, or people who aren't black say it, in their feelings, because it's just something about that word that still stings to people, to black people.
Yeah. I was gonna mention that too. Whenever, even when a white person says the ending with the A, black people get mad because you understand that what they're trying to say. You understand that there's a certain, the way they say it is different from the way black people say it. And I don't even like it when black people say it, but you understand that historical context of when a white person says it as opposed to a black person says it. And my thing about the word is that you can't go anywhere and hear any other culture group use negative words and try and flip it into a positive, you know, a positive term of endearment.
Exactly.
Now, you won't hear now. You wait. You won't hear Japanese calling each other Japs. You won't hear
I've heard plenty of Asians of different nationalities be like, "What's up? What's up, slant?"
No, what? Dude, those are those are Americanized. Those are Americanized Asian. And the thing about that is that we have a different culture here. I'm talking about on a broad scale. You don't hear Chinese calling each other chinks. What's up, my chink? You don't hear any other culture group use. You don't hear Polish calling each other Polacks or whatever.
That's why I started with the Slav comparison. And then even if you want to go there, then why do certain Hispanic people call themselves Chicanos? And that was started as a way to almost like a prejudice against different Hispanic people, the word Chicano.
Yeah, but listen to what you just said. You said certain. I'm talking about on a broad scale. It's in our music. It's in our music. It's in our TV shows. It's everywhere. You don't see that with any other culture group. You don't see that with Mexicans. You don't see that with anyone else. And that's my main problem. No, you can't go anywhere and hear.
What I was saying is that there's literally, it's literally a Chicano has become a culture group. It's become a legit. It started off as almost as an insult.
Well, it is.
It is. I don't see it, but a lot of people do, because it's almost like when black people call each other bougie. It's like they're just most when black people call you bougie. It's almost like, you know, like, oh, you think you're better than me. Like, Chicano was originally a term for Mexicans in America that thought they were better than Mexicans in Mexico. Of course she left. So yeah. So what I'm saying is I'm immune to it now. What I'm saying is there is a difference. I mean, there's people that do that, and then there's also the Slavs. So again, like, are you gonna deny that, you know, because Slavs call themselves Slavs, that literally discounts all of the great nations that Slavic people have created?
I mean, there's exceptions to every rule, and I acknowledge that. But like I said, you really don't see this. It'd be different if this was everyone doing this. But the problem is, you can only point to very small little portions of people doing it.
But do you know what Hispanics, Slavs, and African Americans have in common, though? They all dealt with enslavement-like conditions for multiple periods of time. So if you could say that all enslaved peoples don't come out with almost like a reflection of their enslavement, then I could agree. But the three biggest, I mean, you can even count count what do they call? I'm blanking so hard right now. Irish people. Irish people insult each other with their slurs all the time. Like, my great grandfather was Irish. And I used to call him a potato head all the time, and he just start laughing. I was like, this man gives no fucks. But if you look on different UK television shows and over in Ireland, their media, their real media, it's like they kind of refer to themselves as different jokes. You know, even now, I've seen people from UK. I've seen Gordon Ramsay do this all the time. He'll see a person from Ireland, or he'll find out they're from Ireland, he'll make a bunch of jokes about the great potato famine, like, and they'll just laugh along with it. It's like, you know, but like, y'all gonna act like a bunch of people didn't die from that? So I think it's almost like how Americans have a bunch of 9/11 jokes. Like, 9/11 was terrible. It was crazy. Like, 4,000 people died. A lot of damage was done. But it doesn't stop the massive amounts of 9/11 jokes. And I feel like, you know, I forgot, it was like a quote that says like comedy is tragedy or something. But I feel like these great events in different cultures and histories always end up becoming almost like a joke. Because who's honestly about to sit around all day and just be like, 9/11, that was, oh my God, 9/11, oh my God. Great Potato Famine, oh my God, oh my God. Roman Empire enslaving millions of Slavic people and the Byzantine following them, oh my God. Like, you know, slavery, you know. But I just feel like that is really a deflection from what really matters to people. I mean, not what really matters, but what really helped the community en masse. So I don't know, like I've seen and I've heard nigga all my life. And like I said, I went through the phase where I didn't say that, but now I don't care. And if a white person says it, now if a white person says nigga, I'm gonna like distance myself away from them. Because white people don't say it the same way we say it.
And exactly.
We all know this, and that's why we don't like to hear it.
Yeah.
Majority of white people don't say it the same way we do.
Mm-hmm.
They say it because they feel the need to say it. Not because it's like, oh, cool, nigga. It's like, no, it's like, oh, man, I wonder if I can get away with saying nigga because they might get hurt by that. So, and my stance is, I don't care if white people say nigga, but I also don't care what happens to them when they say nigga. So
fair enough.
So, you know, it's like, I think it's different. I don't think Hispanics should have been allowed to say nigga because they're just not, they've never been there. A lot of them have never been there. They've never been in the position to are you guys still on my call?
Yeah, just I'm listening.
Yeah, no, I'm talking about Casey just texted me.
Okay.
But like, let me send that. Okay, so what was I saying? With the Hispanics, a lot of them haven't been there. I've seen more ride or die white people than Hispanics, if I'm going to be honest. And I just think it's their culture, you know. So I don't know. I don't think it's that serious. But I know when to say nigga. I know when not to say nigga. It's like, when I go to Memphis, my accent shifts back a little bit to Memphis. When I go to certain sides of Chicago, my accent shifts, my personality shifts. It changes on the environment I'm in. And if I could complain about one thing, is that black people don't know how to shift their tones to the environment they're in to better adapt to the situation and just do better as well. So yeah.
Okay, well, I believe that just about wraps up the podcast. And, you know, we had Casey dropping out, but we'll have her back next time. Until next time, we'll be off in the cut.